Now, David Lean's movies were nominated for a staggering 57 Academy Awards, of which 27 of them won Oscars. Much is known, of course, about his professional life, but he was always very reticent about talking on the personal side. Well, his wife Sandra has just published a book called An Intimate Portrait, telling the behind-the-scenes stories from a personal perspective. And we're absolutely delighted to welcome today Sandra Lean. I thought, actually, we would start off by the meeting. I mean, just where you met David.
Oh, gosh, do you want to be here for an hour?
I do. I want to hear it all.
OK, I'll be very brief. I actually love food shopping, so I was in Harrods and I was in the vegetable department and suddenly caught sight of this wonderful sort of lion's head which stood above the crowd. And I found myself in a different part of the store about 5 minutes later, and I went up to him and congratulated him on his films. At which point he chatted for a long time, about 20 minutes, and then I said, well, I really must go now, and he did not know my name. Anyway, I had been to a clairvoyant 3 days before who had told me that probably in my life there'd be somebody called Dad something. And I said, oh, it's, you know, my mother talking about my father, whose name was David, but no, it wasn't. So I went home, and there was a cousin of a girlfriend of mine who was writing a book in my basement in my house, who visited her. And I said, oh, I forgot to tell you, I bumped into David Lean today, at which point he said, well, that's very strange. He said, because Sarah Lean, who's David's niece, was a great friend of his, and he was dining with them all that night.
And so did he bring you along to meet him again?
No, he didn't. And I said, will you please promise not to mention anything? Because I really, you know, this was just a meeting. He doesn't know my name and it's better just left alone. So finally, he had to break his promise because David was in one of his silent moods where he did not speak much that evening. And it was highly loaded when David didn't speak, I can assure you, and nobody else spoke. But anyway, what had happened was that he had been thinking about this person he'd met and would never meet her again, and so Dickon broke his promise and formally...
Said, I know where she is.
..formal introduction was made later on.
Now, did you inquire about his other five wives, because you were the sixth? I mean, were you worried about becoming the sixth?
Do you know, it's very strange. Somebody else asked me that question the other day. No, I didn't worry about it at all, and I was very curious. So I talked to him about these relationships, because I was interested, because I thought, well, what is his past is his present and his future, and mine is too. So why not know?
Did he talk about it willingly or not?
Yes. He said, but, you know, you're the first one, the first, what did he call it, your first woman in my life that's asked me about my other women. And he was quite willing to talk, because if one made light of it, that was fine. But he had sort of horror stories about, you know, one or two of the relationships.
And is it true that if he lost interest, say, in the wife, in the woman in his life at that time, and if perchance she or anybody else around tried to get in the way of filmmaking, that he would just eliminate that person? He had this facility of just taking them out of his life, really.
Yes, he just said, you know, you have to just cut. Which, of course, was a word that he used a lot and practiced a lot in film, but he did cut people out of his life. And they ended up like binned footage on the cutting room floor, really.
And so you had to remain exotic and interesting and keep his attention.
Well, I think basically, yes, that, but I think he craved affection and he craved loyalty. And he didn't like people that played games at all. So I think if one was all of those things, and also a great interest in what he was doing.
Sure. Well, let's have a look, because there's so much we could talk about, of course, in terms of his career, but Brief Encounter is one film that people always quote. Now, Noel Coward, I gather, was actually very good to him at the very beginning of his career.
Yes.
So what happened in that case?
Well, what happened with Noel Coward? Well, Noel, David was the highest paid editor in England. And he, Noel, was making a film in which is called In Which We Serve. And David went along for an interview to be assistant director, actually. And Noel said, well, that's all right, you can be assistant director. And David said, no. He said, I want to be co-director. And Noel said, but whoever's heard of you? And so David said, well, they soon will. And that was the beginning, really, of his...
His
directorial career, because he then went on to make his own movies.
Well, of course, Brief Encounter goes down in history as being one of the great, great love stories, but complicated at the same time. So,
yes.
But, of course, much of that film was carried out at the railway carriage, you know, while they waited. And I gather that in David's own life, that he used to hang around. He didn't really like going home because his mother used to cry a lot after the split
divorce
with her husband.
Split up of the parents. And therefore, he never, ever liked people crying around him. And, you know, if one got depressed and started to cry, that was the end. You know, he couldn't stand anyone that cried.
So what did he say about Brief Encounter?
A Brief Encounter, actually, I say, really, that David was mirrored in that film. I mean, he's definitely Trevor Howard in that film. He was a romantic. And that film... is the sort of woman that David really rather liked in his life. A woman that didn't come over too strongly, that was, you know, quiet. And but this was the romance that actually was never came to anything. And
it had a strong moral story, really.
It had a very strong moral story, yes. And I think it also had a fantastic sexuality and sensuality about it without seeing anything on the screen.